you do if someone was fighting with your mother? Would you defend her honor? What if your sister was being attacked by another girl? Would you separate them? Or would you join in the tussle to save your sister from injury? And what if your able-bodied brother was in a fight? He was being attacked by multiple assailants. You are not aware of the circumstances surrounding the fight, but you can't very well stand at attention while your brother is being pulverized. That split-second decision could be the most significant second of your entire life. Every prisoner has a story of why they are behind bars. Some are ridiculous. Some are laughable. Others deserve no mercy. And then, there are those whose fates seem understandable. Astonishingly, when we are the victims, we call for the perpetrator's head. But when the defendant comes from our door, we beg and plead to every possible mercy committee. This 54-year-old convicted killer has four sisters and four brothers. For years, he has clutched these bars and pondered on the biblical question, am I my brother's keeper? His name is Stephen Mongrew.
Stephen Mongrew, walk me through the events that led to your incarceration.
I was in St. living in St. Vincent with my father. And I decided to come to see my mother down to St. Lucia. Spend a couple of days with her before I go back home. I was due to leave St. Lucia on the 11th to meet the last few days of Carnival, which was ending on the 14th of that same July month in St. Vincent. But when I reached Beaufort, we had some disappointment with the boat I was supposed to go down with. So I had to cancel the trip for the 12th. But unfortunate for me, when I left Beaufort and came back down to Castries, to my mother's place, Cicero, and she told me, well, like, son, but you promised me to make a yard broom for me for so long. And since you came back to D, and you didn't travel anymore, so why don't you do it for me now? Because when you leave tomorrow, I don't know when I would see you again. So I took a knife and I proceed to go and look for the coconut sticks for my mother. When I reached by the Cicerone Combined School, I saw my brother and I called him and I told him, well, like, should in case he saw Don, tell Don to come to meet me in the hall. That is where I was supposed to go and gather the coconut sticks to make the broom for my mother. When I left by the school area and walked about 50 yards, I heard a shouting. Coco Coco, which is the nickname they call me by. Your brother is fighting. So I turned back, going to attend to the situation to see how I could have helped. And it just out of the blues, that guy just rushed me, unexpectedly. When he made the first grab at me, when I bent my head, my heart kind of half came out because I was wearing a cap that afternoon. And then I was trying to fix the car. At the same time, he came against me. The same way, I have the knife in my waist. I tried to pull out the knife, trying to scare him off by he seeing the knife, but it was too late. He was just plunging into the knife at the same moment.
What happens after you stab him?
No, after he got, well, I did not actually stab the guy, sir. The guy plunged into the implement which I was holding. When that took place after the guy got hurt, then he left by the Cicerone Combined School and ran towards the Cicerone Community Center while my brother was running after him.
Where was your brother when you stabbed the guy?
My brother was in a scuffle with the other guys that was along with Charles, with the guy who got stabbed. He was in a scuffle with them. So when he realized the guy was running, when the other guys realized the guy got stabbed, everybody jumped up, like panic, like in a panic way. So my brother started running after the guy, going down towards the CCM Community Center. And just about, I said 20 or 30 yards before they meet the community center, right there in the junction to go into my home there, they had a scuffle. And I was trying to pull out my brother from the guy and tell him, well, like, the guy has already been hurt, so leave the guy alone.
Why do you think the guy attacked you?
Most probably he knew I was Alex's brother. That's the only thing I could think of. I don't know. Because I did not know the guy, I never saw him before, I never had any problem with him before, I never had any contractions with him before.
And when he falls in the gutter by the community center, did somebody pick up a stone and drop on him?
No, sir. Not to my knowledge.
Was your brother hitting him with a post when he was running away?
Well, it wasn't a post. It was a rotten piece of stick because according to information received on me, they said my brother had a baseball bat. I could imagine somebody hitting somebody with a baseball bat on their head. Had to cause some damage, a buzz head or something, but it was nothing like that to say, well, like they had a buzz head or a lump in the guy's head to say, well, like he got hit by some object which had weight or could have caused any harm or death to the guy. Cannot rule that.
What was your relationship with the deceased?
No, as I told you, I don't know the guy. I never saw him before. I never knew the guy. I never had no problem with the guy.
Did you plan to kill him that day?
No. No. Nothing like that was on my mind. Because, I mean, considering a human being, you can't just plan to kill somebody, sir. Why should you want to take somebody's life just like that for no reasons whatsoever? Even if you know they're in the contraction with your brother or something, or your family member, or even your child, why should you want to kill somebody?
When you went there and you realized that a fight was going on, why didn't you pull your brother away?
I did not have time to reach my brother. I did not have time to reach my brother. It was while approaching, the guy just rushed me. I myself panic. As I told you, I panic. At the same time in the panic, I took off the knife on his second lunge. And the same pulling out the knife, the guy just lunged to the guy. Because according to the information I received from the postmortem from Dr. Stephen King, the knife never did not use with any force. Never used with any force. Like the guy plunged into the implement which I was holding. I never denied I had the implement that causes the guy death. I never denied that fact. But to say just walk to the guy and stab the guy, I did not do that. Because that witness, Mary Gilbert, according to what I could remember, said the guy was standing by a telephone booth with his hands folded in that manner. And I just walked up to him, raised his left hands with my right hands and just took out the knife and stabbed the guy.
Is that what happened?
No, sir. But I'm telling you what she said. And nothing like that never transpired.
The deceased, 24-year-old Joshua Charles, collapsed here. Samaritans picked him up and transported him to the Victoria Hospital, where he succumbed to his injuries. The police arrested Alex Mungroo, the brother who was originally involved in the fracas. But the prime suspect would take police on a wild manhunt.
I stayed on the run for the night because I did not want to accept what I heard. You understand? I went home to my mom's place and she was devastated. Like, yeah, so I'm saying. And my sister came down from Virgin Gordon at the same time, my older sisters. My second sister living up the Gaza came and the rest of the family gathered together and they told me, well, like, do not let them see Alex until I bring in myself. That's what I'm saying. So now I was wondering, well, like, what is the next step? What am I going to do? So I left them home and I went away. I went on by the Cicerone beach and I called out until the following day.
You went to hide?
Went to hide. I went in hiding. You understand? A very sad morning while I was by the beach, while I was contemplating to take a shower, I saw Boston Whaler was coming towards me. And rail officers in plain clothes, not in uniform, but with guns and whatnot and whatnot. So when I saw them, I didn't panic. I just ran up to a little area that was there. And what they call, they used to call it Lover's Lane, right? That's before they construct that road there, or it is there right now. So I went in and I just lay down on the grass between some stones there, and I just lay down there and I dropped asleep. When I woke up, it was about after 2-3 o'clock in the afternoon, about 9 o'clock in the morning. I wait until evening time, about 6-7 o'clock. And I went home to my parents' place. And they tell me, well, like, the police is not letting them see Alex because he had some bite on his face. But he went to the hospital, and I think he got affected in his eye. So I waited until about between 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock in the night. And my sister went to call my cousin, which is Claudius Joseph, to assist with transportation for me to bring in myself in to the police, which I did.
Much to the surprise of the lead investigator, Joseph Eugene, Mongru turned himself in. His was a virgin face.
It was like just seeing the whole police force, like the one parade, just passing one by one, like in a line, just to see who I was. Because as I told you, like, never been involved in criminal activities before.
Tuesday, July 14th, 1992. Alex and Stephen Mongru are in police custody. They are both charged for the murder of Joshua Charles. The older Mongru was fully cooperating with law enforcement.
When I explained to Mr. Valenjohn, my brother didn't do anything to cause any grievous harm to the guy. I was the one who was holding the implement who caused the guy's death. You understand? So I'll just take the responsibility for the matter. It's true, it was my brother who was in the fight. You understand? But I was the one holding the implement who causes the guy's death.
Why did you choose Valenjohn?
No, I did not choose Valenjohn. It was legal aid lawyer. Valenjohn was a legal aid lawyer, which they gave me at the moment.
Were you satisfied with his representation?
No, sir, I was not.
Coming up, one of the most exciting prison breaks in the history of St. Lucia. And later, one man will be hung by the neck. When someone is placed under arrest and their memoranda rights have been read, officers advise them that if they cannot afford an attorney, one will be provided for them. What they fail to say is that the success rate of legal aid lawyers in St. Lucia is slim to non-existent. Stephen Mongru learned this the hard way. He was represented by this man.
Tell me about your trial.
I was not satisfied with my trial, boss man. To be honest, it is, I was not satisfied with my trial. Because first to begin, when Julieta Valsen came to the stand and made a statement, she was never cross-examined by the lawyer or by the prosecutor or anybody else. Mary Gilbert, likewise. And the evidence to give was conflicting. As I said, and I would say again, I never denied having the implement that caused the guy's death. But the circumstances surrounding it was all lies.
Why didn't you plead for manslaughter?
The lawyer never came or asked me to. So I don't know if I had the power within myself, because since I had a lawyer representing me, you understand? Because to go a little bit further, when the prosecutor asked me, I have three choices. One, I could stay in the box and give a statement and I will not get questioned. Two, I could go on the witness stand and I would get questioned by the prosecutor, by the judge, and by the jurors. So I said to him, like, I wanted to go on the witness stand. Mr. Valentine turned back and told me, no, stop in the box. Not knowing at that time when you stop in the box is a form of guiltiness.
You are in court and the sentence is read. Guilty of murder. What goes through your head?
Man, to be honest with you, boss, man, at the moment that transpired, it didn't shift me to the extent to say, well, like, shift me per se, because it was too glaring to me. It was too glaring in the manner that it happened, of not receiving justice, proper justice, proper representation, and the things which was said. And to see what, like, you just been sentenced to death just like that, it was just like, but what is going on? What is really going on?
Do you think you should have been set free?
No, boss man. No, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that, sir. But the more lenient sentence, at least, because I did not premeditate to just take a man's life. I did not just leave my home for life and just go and look for somebody to kill somebody. I was on an errand for my mom. You understand what I'm saying? And so it comes around, it happened in that woman. I did not plan to rob anybody or have robbed anybody or done any things like that before. So I don't see why should I kill somebody just like that. It's a human life we're talking about, sir. It's a life we're talking about, sir.
You were sentenced
to hang.
And when
the
judge
4th of March, 1994.
Tell me life as a condemned prisoner at Her Majesty's.
Well, it hasn't been easy, sir. Because the 5 years, 3 months on death row, it was not easy. The only time I would feel normal like any other individual is on a Friday afternoon, when you see 6:15, and nobody didn't come to me and say, well, like, okay, Mr. Mongrel, or come to read a death warrant to me, or, you understand what I'm saying? Anytime 6:15 to Sunday evening at midnight, I would feel good. But anytime 12:15 to Monday morning again, you're living on edge, sir. You're never stable, sir. At any appointed time, because don't forget you live on borrowed time. At any appointed time, they could just come and read a death warrant for you, sir. And saying that you as an individual, a human being, I mean, you're not sick, you don't have a problem. And to see somebody coming to tell you that on such a certain time or such a certain date, you're gonna be hanged by your neck and hung in a rope for an hour. I mean, it's not easy, you know? It's not easy.
In September 1994, Stephen Mongrew's appeals were denied. Death by hanging was now a certainty. That left Mongrew with only one option.
The guys had the small accents. Where they got it from, I don't know. How they got it, I don't know. All what I know, like, they introduced it to me and told me, like, they already have the tools for the escape. And if I stay in St. Lucia, I'm going to get executed. You understand? And they had already saw the bars in the bathroom area where we was using, because it was high risk, eh? And they had already saw the bars. So inside to each bar that was saw was plastered by back with some ash and blue soot. So when you pass, even though you look, it had the same gray color, but you wouldn't see no mark. You know what I'm saying? So that happened. We did that between the 18th and the 19th. The morning of the escaping, which was the 20th, I had a piece of plywood in my cell. Now those times we used to use buckets at Her Majesty's prison to use our barrels and food. So I got a nail
and I took the bucket from underneath so the urine would run on the board. So obviously the officer have to put off that board, let somebody scrub it up for me to organize it to put it back in the cell. And we use that same board to put between the condom section on the top to the wall of the prisons to walk over when we came from the condom's bathroom.
What happens next?
Well, things get hot. Well, there was a certain guy who was supposed to collect us because we received information from him where like everything was all right and boat was waiting for to take off man of St. Lucia and whatnot and whatnot. And when we reached out there was no ride. Now we've been in incarceration for over a year or so, not training and anything was. When you run at this 5 yards, you burnt out. Now don't forget your life in jeopardy. The life in danger because I mean I have already wanted dead or alive. A death warrant has been signed for me. So I mean, no mercy.
The adventures of the Fabulous Four would take them to our southerly neighbor, where Mongru was originally based. Mongru was accompanied by a dream team of criminals.
What islands did you all go to after your escape?
Well, we spent about 21 days in St. Lucia. And from here, we went over to St. Vincent. When we reached St. Vincent, we hijacked a boat and tried to make it to Grenada. And from Grenada, we go up to Trinidad.
Your fellas were on a tour. You all escaped St. Lucia, you all go to St. Vincent, you all go to Grenada. What you all had, the Cunard?
No, we didn't have time to reach Grenada. That was our next destination.
What happened?
We had planned. But eventually when we reached St. Vincent, we proceeded on our way to Grenada after we passed Beckway. And, well, I know that area the very well. I know St. Vincent and Beckway and this area very well, you understand? But when I saw Moose Stick, and the other guys made me believe, well, like, they knew St. Vincent, but the guys did not know St. Vincent. But just that they had the fear of the water within them. So before they saw a piece of land, they thought, well, like, it was safe. So I tell them, no, well, like, this is Moose Stick Island, and you cannot go to Moose Stick. So let's continue, because you had Myro, Petit Martinique, and Carriacou, Union Island. Then you know what I'm saying? Grenada. But when they saw Moose Stick, which is just below Beckway, they considered, well, like, okay, that was where we was going. But I tried to tell them no. But they were so in a haste and three against one. So I had no choice but to proceed with them.
Now that they were safely on land on the wrong island, a native unknowingly offered assistance to the wanted fugitives. But little did they know, their adventure had just begun. Mark McIntosh was shot dead, but for Mongru, Trevor London, and Godfrey Williams, it was death or recapture, or both.
So at the same time, one of the guys turned back and he said, well, like, look, two guys standing out there. So at the same time, I'm turning back and I'm shouting SSU. And the same time we're shouting SSU, the same time they're opening fire. So I took the ground for me and crawl on my fours and move away from them while bullets was bursting. I heard one of the guys bawl out, "Woo!" When I looked back, I saw he was lying on the ground. So I continued running. So when I went left and I realized I was going back to the danger zone, I went back right. When I reached right to cross a piece of lawn because there was a house which one of the guys had already penetrated through, I saw officers with feet, guns in hands and walking about, so I freeze. And I saw they had a heap of rubbish, garbage. So I had no choice, boss man. Sir, excuse me. But to just take out my shirt and make way and enter under that garbage. Spend 7 hours under that heap of garbage there. While some biting aunt was making some good love to me. Yeah, stand. 7 hours. Yeah. And if I shift
and right there, like I'm here underneath the garbage heap, and right by that black suitcase there, there is an officer sitting on an ice box with his gun in his hands and a dog.
And finally, the day Mongru hoped would never come.
When I enter, I saw signs like persons was working on the gallows and the gallows was already painted.
On Sunday, July 12, 1992, Alex Mongru is locked in a vicious fight with Joshua Charles and some other young men near the Cicero Combined School. His older brother, Stephen Mongru, on hearing of the scuffle, runs to the scene, only to find himself embroiled in the melee. When Mongru comes to his brother's aid, 24-year-old Joshua Charles is fatally stabbed. Stephen Mongru is subsequently arrested, charged, and convicted for the offense of murder. In 1994, he was sentenced to death by hanging. But after 8 months on death row, Mongru and three other criminals scaled the walls of the Royal Jail. The prisoners made it all the way to Mustique Island in the Grenadines. Their run from the law could easily be a Hollywood blockbuster, but the adventure was about to go sour in a hurry.
Godfrey Williams was shot. Trevor London was arrested and sent back to St. Vincent. Well, from day one, we haven't seen Mac McIntosh. And Mongru is on the run by himself right now.
Mongru was recaptured by a mob who marched him down to the Mustique police station.
The Coast Guard, St. Ocean Coast Guard came down and they picked me up from Mustique and brought me back to the mainland, St. Vincent, to pick up Godfrey Williams and Trevor London. They had Roger Healy and the next guy named Shandy. So they brought us back to St. Lucia. That is where you go see nastiness when I reach on that wharf there. Because the superintendent of prisons at that time was Mr. Randolph Walk. Yuck. Man come with a piece of metal pipe and from at the back of the jeep, man, piss my head. Imagine I could not even lie down because anytime I lie down, like as if I seen the whole thing spinning, you could have actually seen my brains moving.
Why did he burst your head?
You understand what I'm saying, boss, man? Real leg down, I tell you. You know what, man? Boom, boom, me. Massage, iron, lash all on my skin and everywhere, you understand what I'm saying?
You made York look bad.
You know what I'm saying?
By escaping.
Well, definitely, that's what he said. I undermine the security system. But, boss man, you cannot blame me because of the injustice which I think I suffered.
After Mongru's recapture, he spent 6 months at Central Police Station. Then, he was transferred back to Her Majesty's. But a deadly surprise awaited him.
When I enter, I saw signs like persons was working on the gallows and the gallows was already painted in red and you could have seen the excitement in it. So it was just like I was just walking. I don't know how to explain it, boss. And the feelings I got, I cannot explain that, boss, man. I cannot explain that. I cannot explain it, sir. I cannot explain it. It is a feeling that you cannot explain.
Somebody would say, you killed somebody, so you should die. What's your take?
Mr. Elliot, even I try to answer you that question, sir, I cannot make you feel what I felt at that moment. Because imagine you're in a condemned cell, in a cell. Okay? And there is no way out of that cell.
Yes, but somebody will say as well, imagine you at a school bazaar and somebody stabs you to death. You took the life of somebody, whether in joke, in jest, by accident or otherwise, you caused somebody's death.
Yes.
Why now run away from your own?
I had an implement to cause the guy's death, but I will repeat to you again, sir. I never premeditated to take anybody's life. I've got brothers, I've got sisters, I've got children. Why should I just take somebody's life just like that? Even I was protective over my family, but why should you do that? To gain what reputation?
When you fall asleep that night after the death warrant is read, what's going through your mind?
I didn't sleep, boss. I didn't sleep. How could you sleep? About 15 minutes after they read the death warrant, you could actually hear the jackhammer breaking the wall, digging your hole. How could you sleep? Where would that come from? Asleep? What do you call asleep? Right now you're contemplating asking the Almighty God to turn you invisible. You want to turn to an ant. You're looking for all kind of impossible objects to turn yourself into right now to try and escape that. You know, you're just coming there. You understand? But the Almighty God was so great that I got a vision from my grandmother who has already died. And I was going down in that river of dirty water. And that lady came and she told me, Ishmael, they're trying their best to drink your blood, but it is not easy. And she pulled me out. And I said, yeah, praise God. I am safe.
So
praise
the
Almighty God.
You know them waters have a way of drinking fellas' blood after they hang them.
My blood.
Red water.
That man was not there that time. That man just correct.
That's an old name. That's water. I know. I'm just teasing you, man.
That's what I'm saying, boss. Yeah, I mean. I'm laughing there right now, you know, boss man, because, but it was not nothing easy, you know. It was not easy. Understand? And on the 26th of July, at about quarter to 1 and 5 o'clock, then I got a stay of execution. Because I was supposed to be executed on the 27th, the following morning.
The night before?
Yeah, the night before I got this self-execution. You understand? They read the death warrant for me on the 20th to be executed on the 27th. About 15 minutes after the death warrant, they read the death warrant, my hole was already being dug. And I could actually hear the jackhammer breaking concrete and going through it. Okay? And on the 26th of July, between 5 and 5 o'clock, I got a stay of execution.
Stephen Mongrew was placed with the general population for the first time in August 1999.
I worked at the kitchen for about 6 months, and from the kitchen, I ended up getting the opportunity to do a course in Creole, reading and writing, to learn to read and write Creole. There were 15 of us. And the course was supposed to be for a year, and we did it in 9 months. And I had the opportunity to taught inmates to read and write Creole at board lays for about 2 to 3 years.
They say board lays for the rehabilitation of offenders. Do you think that they've done a good job with you?
Yes, yes. Now, when it comes to the rehabilitation process, sir, in spite of what you would give me, it is up to me to accept.
Mongrew was described as a pleasant, helpful, and model inmate. For the past 4 years, he has been employed in the general maintenance section of the prison. He is one of the very few prisoners who command the respect of the penal population and prison officers.
Your incident was not an accident, but it was not intentional.
No, sir.
There are other situations where a little boy will pull out a knife to defend himself or come to the defense of his sister, and something like that will happen. In hindsight, what do you think would have been done differently to prevent you from being here?
Okay. I think I was being too protective of my family. I was growing up as a little boy. I witnessed my mom
was being abused by my father. My elder sister's been abused by my father. I myself and my brothers and sisters been abused by our father. And there is nobody he could have talked to. And there's nothing he could have done. He just had to stay and take whatever he does. When my father left my mother and went over to St. Vincent, I was just about 15 years of age. And when daddy left mommy, there was nobody, nobody to take care. Nobody to take care of somebody. It was dread. Yes, sir. My elder sister had got trapped with two kids. My second sister was not working. My third sister was adopted by my father's mother. Well, she was no more at the moment, but it was all me. That same time, I passed common entrance to go to the entry-course secondary school, and I had to give up school to look for work, to see about my family. Still, anything that happened was my answer. I didn't mean for anything to happen, but it just happened. Still. And from then I had to be the one responsible for the family. So in this reason, I was very protective over my family because of what they're going through in the home. So.
How do you think this could have been avoided?
I don't know, sir. I really don't know, sir. To be honest, I don't know. But if I did not have the weapon that day, it would not have happened. I guarantee you that it would not have happened. But I don't know if it's because of I had the weapon and in the manner that it happened, because I myself was kind of panicked. So I thought, well, like to scare off the guy. You understand, by showing him, but at the same time he was just plunging in, at the same time I pulling out the knife. I would like to say to the family of the guy, you understand? I'm very sorry for what transpired. I didn't mean to take anybody's life, but just in the manner of how it happened and so fast. You understand? I'm sorry. I'm asking them to forgive me, because I know, like, I've heard St. Lucia, the people of St. Lucia, and all the boys' family, also my family. I'm asking them to forgive me for that.
To society, who may be wary of you coming back, you being violent, what would you like to say to them?
I've never been that violent person, sir. First time I ever got myself involved in a situation like this. I've never involved or partake in any other criminal activities. Before this incident took place, I've always been a family man. Always tried to avoid any kind of trouble.
Conflict resolution is a process involved in facilitating the peaceful ending of a dispute. It is never what happens at the beginning of a fight that matters, but rather the end result of split-second decisions. In Stephen Mongru's case, his lack of effective conflict resolution skills led to the death of a man. There have been many more people like Stephen Mongru over the past 22 years. Many have made similarly fatal errors. The onus is on our society, our policymakers, our parents and teachers to formally impart the skills which would teach children how to deal with inevitable conflict, thereby reducing the number of lives lost and stories from behind prison walls. Parents, teachers and policymakers, remember, tell a child about conflict resolution and they will listen. Teach them and they may remember, but involve them and they will certainly learn. Coming up.
Have you sentenced people to death? who, in your opinion, were not the worst of the worst?
Yes.
It is not often that the best legal minds in St. Lucia come together to rally for one man. But this case is an enigma to defense counsels, prosecutors, and judges.
Stephen Mongru was not to say involved in a heinous crime where there was to say that it was something out of spite. There was no motive for it. It was just like, for instance, it was not a drive-by shooting, or it was not a person unprovoked. Stephen Mongru at the time, from how the facts emerged from the case, witnessed another person attacking his brother or something like that, if I can recall. The two of them, the brother and Stephen, were indicted, and I can recall the brother getting off on a no-case submission at the time. In my view, I do not believe by any stretch of the imagination that the facts of Mongru's case warrants a term of life imprisonment. I mean, I say that without reservation. That is my opinion. For the simple reason that these are people who are involved in a fight. There was a physical altercation between the two people. He was called, he was wherever he was, at some telephone booth or the other, whatever the situation was in Cicero. And I recall, and then you ask yourself in a situation like that, even if one were to assume that the finding by the jury at the time was that Mongru had used excessive force, let us assume that that was the finding of the jury. Would one want to consider that the worst of the worst? In any event, that is why I'm telling you that that was the justification and the wisdom in Parliament making the distinction between the non-capital and capital. But do you believe that these are circumstances which ought not to warrant a fixed term of imprisonment?
Let me give you the sort of case that circumstance, I think, deserves a death sentence. A deliberate assassination for money. A murder committed in the course of some other crime, such as rape or burglary. Those two circumstances, in my view, deserve a death sentence. A murder committed in the course of a fight, where both parties are fighting, does not deserve a death sentence.
I can tell you that there are several cases, and that is an area of the law that I think that the powers that be need to take a very serious look at, not necessarily only because of the situation of overcrowding in our prisons, but also because of the constitutional implications that it creates. It seems to me that under the 1992 code, the judges administering justice in the courts of St. Lucia felt that after the court was given the discretion to sentence to a lesser term, a lesser form of punishment, that the only alternative to the death penalty was a mandatory life sentence, as opposed to a discretionary life sentence or a term of years, which is really the practice now under the Criminal Code 2004, which explicitly sets out sentencing guidelines for judges.
Have you sentenced people to death who, in your opinion, were not the worst of the worst?
Yes, because that was the law. I know a woman who was given a very short period of time. We have many instances, I'd rather not call names, that were given 3 years for charged with murder, found guilty of manslaughter, and 5 years at the High Court, 3 years on appeal. It was a killing. Somebody died. Those who commit murder now seem to be, if you want to say it, luckier than those who did it before. Because they come under this 204 code where there's capital, non-capital, and it's still murder, and the non-capital can carry a small term of imprisonment. I think some of them are worthy of a term of imprisonment. Now, if they have served, because some of them are there, that's what I know, and there are many before my time, 25 years, they have served 25 years. You can consider the case, look into it, and see whether they can be set free. I think something should be done. That, in my opinion, he is one of those that should be considered to be released.
Mongru's case is certainly not unique in circumstances. However, as sentences go, he appears to be the victim of society's shifting morality threshold. In 1992, the law was clear. Once you are convicted of murder, regardless of the mitigating circumstances, your fate was death by hanging. In that year, 4 people were convicted for murder, and 1 was sentenced to death. In the same year, 3 people were found guilty of manslaughter. Fast forward 20 years, and in 2012, 5 people were convicted for murder, and none was sentenced to hang. Whilst 5 were convicted of manslaughter and given sentences ranging from 6 to 20 years. Some of the more memorable cases were persons who have committed a homicide and had been released from prison. At Dax Norville, who served 6 years for killing Raymond Barrow. Christopher Seeley served 7.5 years for the murder of Ives de Turville. There was Urban Desi, remember him? He killed Nanton Ronnie in July 1999. Today, Urban is contributing positively to society. Then, there was Hazel Emanuel, aka Portugal, Frederick Felicien, Terence Vernet, Ambrose Lawrence and Brian Solomon. They mastermind the robbery of a group of British tourists and, in the process, they killed Leonard Wiseman. Under the Criminal Code, Section 8, Subsection B, it states, any murder committed by a person in the course or furtherance of a robbery, burglary or housebreaking is deemed capital murder, which carries a mandatory death sentence. Yet, these murderers serve sentences ranging from 20 to 25 years and have all since been released from prison.
Sherman Rosemond and his brother invaded a party at Bonte on November the 9th, 2003. When asked to leave, the brother began to fight with Bert.
Sherman Rosemond rushed outside, got a knife, and stabbed Bert Norville to death. Very similar circumstances to Mongru's offense. However, Rosemond served 8 years for his crime. Mongru, on the other hand, was sentenced to death. Forgiveness has nothing to do with absolving a criminal of his crime. It has everything to do with releasing oneself of the burden of being a victim, letting go of the pain and transforming oneself from victim to survival. It takes a man, a family, and a country of a certain character to forgive. Consider this. Before an inmate who is sentenced for a violent offense is released back into society, There is no sensitization of the aggrieved family, and the shock of seeing the perpetrator may rehash emotion, which can be very uncomfortable for both the ex-inmate and the family. In the case of Stephen Mongru, we sought the views of the victim's family on Mongru's possible release.
The way I saw it 23 years before, I am different right now. I am more mature, more experienced. I can only speak for myself. I can't speak for my other brothers. But there's room in my heart for forgiveness. And seeing him out there in the streets, I don't know. I can't see that if I see him, for example, on the boulevard, how I'll react. I don't know. I might turn back. I don't know. But I would not want to have any confrontation or say any word to him. That's how I feel for now.
The question remains, why must a 54-year-old man who has been incarcerated for 22 years, who is considered a model inmate and, from all indications, not a threat to society, still be trapped in a birdcage? Why is there no effective parole system to facilitate Stephen Mongru's release? How long is a lifetime? The scales which Lady Justice holds so proudly seem to be perfectly off balance in many cases. The question is, will our collective society sit by and allow Stephen Mongru to die in prison? Our challenge to you, St. Lucia, is to send a letter addressed to the chairperson of the Mercy Committee based on tonight's program, sharing your views to answer one very simple question. Do you believe that Stephen Mongru deserves to die in prison? Feel free to copy us on the mail.
I'm not looking for points here. I don't want nobody to have pity or feel sorry for me. No, but it's just a reality. Never that trouble kind.
Mr. Mongru, do you believe that you are prepared to re-enter society?
If I got the opportunity, sir, I will do the best of it. That's all I'm asking for, just one opportunity, sir.
What can society expect from you?
I don't want to elaborate too much. I just want the opportunity and to prove myself. I could get involved with programs, especially with the younger generation, and share my experience with them. I think I have some knowledge where I could share with them also. Because crime no peace, sir. Violence not be.
Could go on and on, the fool has never been told. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told.